Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hardacre's Luck by C.L. Skelton. Narrated by Justine Eyre. Chapter 1. The last passenger off the Moulton bus was a tall young man carrying a single cheap buff suitcase which swung lightly from his hand, as if it were more than half empty. He was dressed in a sombre dark blue suit, which, being slightly short at both wrists and ankles, gave the impression of something second-hand, and he carried an army greatcoat over his other arm. He hesitated for a moment before stepping to the ground, as if he was uncertain yet that he had reached his destination. Then he descended the last step, one hand still resting on the dusty metal of the coach exterior. Almost reluctantly, he released his grip and turned once around, swinging the suitcase easily. Then, like a homing bird, he set out with purposeful strides eastwards in the direction of the sea. The uncertainty he had shown in the bus station was gone now, and he made his way through the streets of the small seaside city with the assurance of a native. He turned a corner and felt, as he had known he would, a burst of sea-wet air and a sudden gust of salty November wind that cut through his clothing. He hesitated, then set the suitcase down and slipped the coat on over his suit, but left it swinging open as he walked, more quickly towards the waterfront. When he reached the broad promenade, he crossed to the stone wall facing the sea, set the case down once more, and stood leaning over the wall, his eyes on the darkening distance, where the lights of two fishing cables bobbed on the rough sea's surface like early stars. He stood there alone for half an hour, drinking in the remembered delight of the sea. It was getting dark when he at last turned away. The lights of the town were coming on, and they looked cheerful and warm. He was aware suddenly of the cold and the need to find somewhere to stay. He was aware of hunger as well, and the startling necessity of finding a place to eat. He rubbed one long hand over the short stubble of his hair, as if uncertain how to go about the next move. For so long, the necessities of life had been provided, an unthought-of part of the smooth order of the days. To have to seek them out was distinctly odd. Walking more slowly now, he set out along the seafront towards the harbour, the sound of the sea constant to his left, while overhead a huge grey-backed gull shadowed him, crying mournfully, hanging in the air above like a kite on a string. The young man turned to look at it, before it swept away in a widening arc towards Flamborough. Loneliness descended upon him as it departed, a loneliness as deep and physical as grief. He found the cafe at the harbour end of Queen Street. It was a small, dingy affair with tired black-and-white checked curtains, half-shielding its windows, and dust and grime obscuring the rest. But its light shone out welcomingly onto the wet cobbles of the old street, and the tang of vinegar and hot oil drifted into the windy evening. The young man stopped, setting down his suitcase and studying the front of the building. He did not remember it, and yet it was clearly of considerable age, not something that could have sprung up in the 3 years of his absence. He felt in his inner pocket for his new wallet, and glanced within in the dim streetlight, counting the few bills carefully. He replaced the wallet and reached into his trouser pocket, withdrawing his small collection of silver. He counted that too, smiling wryly. 3 shillings and 6p. He replaced it also carefully, picked up the case and crossed the road to the cafe. From the look of it, he wouldn't likely find anything cheaper anyhow. Outside the door, he stopped, looking up, surprised, and a slow smile spread across his face, lighting his dark, somewhat somber eyes. Across the doorway, an ancient wooden board was fastened to the brick wall, and on it, in peeling painted letters, was written the name of the cafe. Or rather, a name of the cafe, since the window boasted a painted sign of its own, proclaiming Charlie's Chips. But the name above the door, disused and weathered, said simply, Hardacre's. He reached up slowly and touched it with the tips of his fingers. Inside, the atmosphere was warm and steamy, smelling of oilskins and the fishy reek of sea gear, and the air was thick with tobacco smoke. There were several small square and round tables, mismatched in size and finish, their surfaces marked with cup stains and cigarette burns, all but one were occupied by clusters of men in fisherman's gear, smoking and talking. They all stopped for a brief moment as he entered, and eyes followed him as he walked uncertainly to the small counter at the far end of the room, where a woman in an apron stood by a large brass cash register, totting up a bill. He waited while she finished her transaction, and gradually the conversations recommenced. The young man sensed he was being discussed. He had ventured into one of those establishments whose customers were so regular and unvarying as to comprise virtually a private club. The woman, square-faced and unsmiling, handed him a stained, hand-printed menu from the limited fare of which he selected cod and chips and a pot of tea. She accepted his order and motioned to a solitary empty table beside the door to the kitchen. The young man sat, sliding his suitcase under the table, and swung open his heavy coat. He did not feel at home enough to take it off. While he waited for his meal, he looked around discreetly, so that the fisherman would not think him rudely curious. The room was shabby, the tiled floor grubby with boot marks. The upper walls were stained darkly yellow with years of smoke. The whole place was permeated with the stench of stale cooking oil. On the walls was a selection of seaside postcards of large-bosomed women and skinny men in preposterous situations, and a few fading framed photographs of the harbour, the priory, and the old town. Half covered over was an ancient poster, printed in red on deeply yellowed white. A Hardacre Cafe welcomes the family. Below the lettering was a Victorian romantic watercolour scene of fanciful children on a fanciful long-ago shore. The young man studied it for a long while, and then turned away. When the aproned woman brought his order, a grease-sodden portion of fish surrounded by limp barricades of chips on a smeary plate, he interrupted her hasty place-laying by pointing to the poster.
"Begging your pardon, but could you possibly tell me where that came from?" he said.
The room stilled again, in response to his public school tones.
"What, dear?" the woman said,
not looking up. She used the word with tired, affectionless boredom.
"The placard, the Hardacre Cafe placard," he said, pointing to it once more.
She poured his tea for him, splashily, and looked up, vague eyes searching the wall.
"Oh, that was always here, best I can recall," she said.
She turned and was already making her way back to the kitchen when he stopped her again.
"Is this a Hardacre Cafe, then?" he said.
He was aware of the perversity of the question, in that he knew the answer and was asking it anyway, for reasons of his own. The woman stopped and looked queerly at him, perhaps in response to the faint note of displeasure in his voice.
"Happen it were," she said. "Would it make any difference?"
She was defensive, and he quickly said, gentling his tone with a small smile,
"It might. Is it?"
She shrugged, more defensive, and said,
"It were a Hardacre Cafe when we bought."
And then, hedging,
"Mind, that were a while ago. My father ran it then."
She turned and hastened to the kitchen door, leaving the young man alone with his thoughts and his cod and chips. He began to eat slowly, finding himself startlingly hungry, and yet repelled by the quality of the food and the atmosphere of his surroundings. From time to time he glanced at the poster with something like annoyance. On one glance, his eyes met those of a big, weather-beaten man, with straggles of greying, sandy hair plastered on his lined forehead, under his navy-blue knitted cap. The man, dressed in yellow oilskin trousers and deep-cuffed fisherman's boots, was conspicuous for having but one arm. His left sleeve ended in an amputee's metal hook. He said, without introduction,
"Now you've done it. Crossed our Mabel, you have. Be a long time before you get a smile out of her again, lad."
"Since when have you ever got one?"
a companion of the fisherman asked, over the pipe he was trying to light. The young newcomer grinned, an engaging grin that won a responsive smile from the one-armed man in the blue cap.
"Sorry about that. I really meant no offence. Just curious, actually."
He was aware of the quality of his voice sounding distinctly out of place.
"Curiosity killed the cat," the fisherman said.
Then, glancing to the kitchen door from whence the sound of running water and clanging pots indicated Mabel's preoccupation, he said in a lowered voice,
Aye, but you touched a sore point. Mabel might like to pretend that Hardacre's sign's an accident, but we're no fools. Free bit of advertising, that is. And Mabel's not one for passing up anything free.
I don't understand, the young man said ingenuously.
No, reckon you wouldn't. Now, you wouldn't know about this, seeing as you don't belong here, he explained quickly. But time was when the name Hardacre over a cafe door meant something. Trippers used to come over from the West Riding and make for a Hardacre tea shop first off.
Why? Asked the young man, finishing the last of his chips.
You mean you never heard of Hardacre? The man with the pipe said. And how would he?
The blue-hatted fisherman cut in at once.
His sort wouldn't be eating in Hardacres in those days. Reckon he's too young anyhow, don't you? Been a long time since Sam Hardacre's day in the East Riding.
They discussed the young man pleasantly, as if he were not present.
You'll have heard of Sam Hardacre, though, the fisherman said then.
The young man nodded, sidestepping the question slightly.
He ran tea shops.
There was a pause. The fisherman leaned back in his chair.
Lad, in my father's day, he didn't just run tea shops. He pretty much run the East Riding. My now them's bygone days. He was a reetin' old Sam Hardacre. My grandfather knew him down Grimsby way. My grandfather had a good herring cobble, and he knew Sam when Sam was just a quayside gutty. That's where Hardacre money come from, you know. Started out selling roll mops at the race meets. Opened cafes then, like this one. Made a lot of money at it. Time went on, he got big, got into hotels, heard he got into railways too. But who knows? Men get big like that, they end up with a finger in every pie. Though I'll say for old Sam, he never changed much. Even when he was living in bloody great house, down Driffield way, he still would come down to Grimsby and stand around Harbourside, chat to folk, like he always done. Was a good man, Sam Hardacre. Ran good, decent places too, not like this rubbish.
He waved a disdainful hand around the rudely decorated walls, mindful to keep one ear cocked towards the kitchen door and Mabel's domain.
There was a day families could count on the Hardacre place, everything neat as a pin, clean, fresh. Used to say his wife, old Mary Hardacre, herself used to come and check up on all his cafes, and if she found anything out of place, or a speck of dirt anywhere, she'd be down on her knees, scrubbing it up herself. Then old Sam would hear and there'd be hell to pay. He was a hard one to work for, but straight, straight as a die. By now he'd turn in his grave if he could see this place, with his name yet hanging over the door, and our Mabel pretending she's not got round to taking it down in 40 years. Reckon there's still the odd country soul comes into town is fooled yet. And if there's one penny left to be fooled out of someone, our Mabel will have it.
He laughed, swigging at his tea, but the young man didn't laugh with him.
Of course, the man with the pipe put in. There aren't any real Hardacre cafes left. Old Sam pulled out just after the war, the first one. Went into other things, I suppose. And his son Joe were a different kettle of fish. A different kettle of fish entirely.
The first fisherman nodded sagely in agreement.
Aye, he said. Joe Hardacre. There was a rate bastard if there ever was one. Opened sweatshops all over the place, till his own father had to come and close him down. Ran off to America then, and got himself in so much trouble he ended up jumping out a window. Right funny how life is. Two like that into one family. Still, it's a way of things. Aye, the pipe smoker laughed. Where there's muck, there's brass, and on t'other hand, where there's brass, there's muck.
They both laughed. The young man did not join in the laughter. He finished his meal solemnly and laid his knife and fork carefully down with an orderliness that defied the casual clutter of the table with its ketchup stains and sticky-necked bottles of fruit sauce and vinegar. Before he finished his tea, a process he was dragging out to allow himself a little longer in the sheltered warmth, he turned around in his chair and addressed the two fishermen who had spoken.
I wonder if you gentlemen could give me some advice.
He was aware of the sideways glances from the other denizens of the cafe, as if any advice given must first be vetted by the entire company.
Happen we could, said the man in the blue cap. If it were the sort of thing we'd know anything about.
He said it with a mixture of reserve and modesty that signalled to the young stranger that he might just be overstepping the bounds.
Thank you, he said carefully. There are two things, actually. I am needing a place to stay for a while. That's the first.
He paused, judging himself wiser to obtain the first answer before venturing the second query.
Up and you're at the wrong end of town, the fisherman said slowly,
tugging at one weather-reddened ear.
Hotels of the sort you be wanting are all up t'other end. Mine, there's the station just up to road, but I don't reckon you'd go much'unt.
He shook his head, and his companion nodded sagely. Actually, the young man said, I wasn't thinking in terms of a hotel. Something more permanent. A guest house, a boarding house, really. He paused, and then said quickly, something a little less dear. There was a silence as the room took in this admission of financial insecurity, and the blue-capped fisherman appeared to be assessing it, uncertain whether he would choose to believe it.
Something less dear, he said at last, to be sure he heard right.
The young man nodded and gave one of his bright grins, which on this occasion won no response. The two fishermen whispered a moment together.
Reckon Jean Hewitt might have a room. Plain enough there, anyhow.
They were talking, still to each other. A nod passed between them. The first fisherman again addressed the newcomer.
Place up St. Hilda Street, Jean Hewitt might do. Food's good, tariffs fair enough. Jean's a good sort underneath. Mind you, takes a while to get underneath. Still, in all her bark's worse than her bite, Jean Hewitt might do you. You're sure now, though, you'd not rather a hotel, he added uncertainly.
Quite certain, the young man said with another smile. I'll try Mrs. Hewitt right now. They nodded, and one said,
It's number 8. Will I show you how to find it?
The young stranger shook his head.
I'll find it, he said.
He rose to his feet, wondering if he'd asked enough questions for one night. He imagined he probably had, but time was pressing.
And the other thing, he added. I'm looking for work. Do you know of anything going? Work, they said together. You meaning a job? Yes, work. A job.
He grinned in spite of himself, wondering how they imagined people like himself to live.
Oh no, lad. There's nothing of the kind of work your sort would want round here. Just the harbour and the fishing and the arcades and cafes down this end. Nothing for your sort.
The young man nodded. He'd have to find that answer on his own, it was clear.
Thank you anyhow, he said. I'll look around. You won't find anything down this end, they said again.
He smiled, and as the venerable Mabel came, brows lowering through the door, he reached into his trouser pocket for his 3 and 6 pence and paid out the 1 shilling and 3 pence for his meal. She took it, unsmiling, and rang up the cash register.
Excuse me, he said. That placard, he said. Now what about that placard, she said with strained good nature.
I want it, the young man said.
You want the placard now, she repeated after him.
Yes, what do you want for it?
There was a moment's confused silence.
For the placard, she said. What do I want? Look, lad, I don't sell placards. What would I be selling that for?
Because I want it. And the sign outside. How much for the pair?
She stood with her rouged face impassive, but for her lowering, red-painted bottom lip. The young man was conscious of the listening ears at the tables all around. He would have to make the next move, for Mabel would no doubt stand there with lowered jaw forever. He reached into his inner jacket pocket and withdrew his wallet, a gesture that aroused a murmur of curiosity from the attentive room. Thinking quickly, with rash impulse, he withdrew a note and extended it, ostentatiously large, to the woman.
£5, she exclaimed. For that thing?
Her voice rose to a shriek of amazement, and there was a quick muttering about the room.
A deal, then, he said quickly.
Sure, she said, if you're as mad as that.
She took the proffered note quickly.
And here's hoping there's more where you come from.
She laughed disdainfully and waved a hand towards the faded advertisement.
Take it, lad. It's yon.
And the sign, he pursued. The sign as well.
Take them both, she said,
laughing to herself as she folded the large note.
£5 for that rubbish, she muttered again,
her voice echoing delight at her bargain and genuine disgust at his foolishness.
Splendid, said the young man.
He strode across the room, suddenly lithe and athletic, and wrenched the tattered card from the wall. He tucked it under his arm and walked to the door, turning to salute the fisherman with a grin. Then he went out into the wet darkness, and, with a sound that was audible within the cafe itself, he reached strong young arms to the old wooden sign and tore it from its mountings on the wall. Then he tucked the sign too under his arm and strode laughing into the windy night. The moment the door closed behind the young man, the attentions of the room, hitherto discreet and diverse, came to a sudden focus on his empty chair. There was a brief silence, in which eyes wandered from the chair to the one-armed fisherman in the blue cap, who had become, suddenly, an authority.
"Well, now," said a fat, cheerful man in a thick-knit grey jumper, who had until now been apparently unaware of the whole event. "What's to make of that?"
"Right queer, if you ask me," answered the pipe smoker.
He tapped ash into a cheap metal ashtray and looked to the man in the navy blue hat. Mabel intervened.
"Daft," she said, still showing her disgust. "Got more money than sense and playing daft with it. Imagine putting out £5 for rubbish like that."
She sniffed, slipping the note into the bottom tray of the brass register.
"Rubbish or not, you seemed happy enough to sell it," the man in the blue hat said over his cup of tea.
Mabel sniffed, slammed the drawer shut, and retired through the battered door to the kitchen. Immediately the conversation in the room brightened and spread to include all aspects of the young stranger, his appearance, his manner, his accent.
"Now what do you make of that?" one said. "First he wants a rooming house, and a cheap one at that. Then he wants work on to fish key. Then he flings fivers about like they're going out of style." "A fool on his money are soon parted," said the pipe smoker.
"Aye, well, but if you ask me, there's more to it than that. He had a right peculiar look about him, that one. Clothes that didn't fit right and a mouthful of marbles.
Actually, I need some advice, gentlemen," the speaker mimicked.
"I reckon he's a proper spiv, that one. Up to no good, anyhow."
"Seemed pleasant enough," said the blue-hatted fisherman.
He tapped the table with his one hand. The artificial one hung down at his side. The disability, the result of a savage encounter with a winch line, had cost him his working life, and he was ashamed of it and strove hard to keep it from showing. He was a thoughtful man, inclined not to judge others harshly, and he didn't like the way the conversation was going.
"Aye," his pipe-smoking companion said. "He would be that, wouldn't he? I'll tell you something I noticed. See the cut of his hair? Right well shaved off, nay, but a stubble it were that short. Now I can think of just about one place where a man gets his hair cut like that."
"Might be just out of the forces," someone put in,
but he was countered easily by the pipe smoker.
"War's been over near enough 5 years. Them that was getting out are all out long since. There was a time I'd have thought the same, mind. They had that look a bit. Mind how it was in 46, every third lad blinking about wide-eyed in a demob suit, looking for work. Nay, not now. And I wager he's no professional just bought himself out either. He can tell them a mile off, all spit and polish even in their civvies. Nay, boys, I know reet off where he's been last year or two."
"And where would that be?"
asked his companion, his eyes on his artificial hand.
"Been inside?"
The fat man at the next table nodded sagely, and around the cafe there was a general murmur of interested agreement.
"I'd put money on it," the pipe smoker said, warming to his theme. "And what's more, he's no ordinary bloke got himself in a bit of trouble with the law. Yon's a proper tough, son of some big family gone bad. Worst kind you can get," he added darkly. "Nay, Mabel," he said to the sour-faced hostess who had reappeared at her doorway to listen.
You'd be wise to give that one short shrift if he shows face around here again. Bloody rubbish.
The pipe smoker looked up from his discourse, surprised. His companion got clumsily to his feet, his false arm swinging loose. Painstakingly, he thrust it through the sleeve of his yellow oilskin jacket that had hung over his chair back and roughly pulled the jacket on.
Of all the bloody presumptuous twaddle, you don't none of you know from anything a damn thing about to lad, and you've well nigh got him tarred and feathered. As for Mabel's placard, well, I'd pay a tenner myself to see the whole damned place stripped of all that rubbish and scrubbed clean. And you needn't look offended, woman. The place is a damn disgrace. If lad shows up again, it'll be his own misfortune. Nay, yarn. I'm off, anyway. Happen I'd rather talk with gulls.
He stalked out into the night, leaving a chastened silence behind. Once outside, he turned on his heel abruptly and made off with a still angry stride towards St. Hilda Street. He walked quickly, cradling his bad arm against his chest as he did when he was in a hurry, and, as he expected, he caught sight of the young man with the suitcase before the latter had achieved his destination.
"Oi, lad!" he shouted into the wind. "Hold on a moment!"
The young man hesitated, looking round, and the old fisherman tried not to let himself read an undercurrent of edginess into the action. He lengthened his stride and caught up with the man with the suitcase at the corner of St. Hilda Street. "Sir," the other said, politely questioning. The fisherman was amused by the formality, but said only,
"Somewhat come to mind soon as you were gone, lad. Job of work needing doing. Mind now, Queen Street, where we was."
He pointed back into the rainy night.
"Yes,"
the young man answered, also peering into the darkness.
"Well, if you go harbourwards 3 or 4 shops, and then across the street there's another chip shop, newer place, run by West Riding folk, come over last year. Recollect now their lass, who was always behind the counter, up and got herself married last week and left the place. Know for a fact they'll be needing a hand there, and if you'd not mind a bit of fish frying, mind now, the wages can't be much, not when they're used to having family labour on the cheap."
He looked doubtful, cocking his head to one side and studying the well-spoken young stranger in the wet streetlight, still uncertain what he was doing here. The young man's face broke into one of his broad grins, and his dark eyes crinkled at the corners.
"I dare say I could fry fish with the best of them," he said,
laughing at some private joke.
"That's capital of you, sir. I can't say how grateful I am."
He glanced across the street at the friendly light of a pub with a ship's wheel motif on the hanging sign above the door.
"Could I stand you a drink, sir?"
The fisherman hesitated, and then, catching sight of the old Hardacre sign still under the other's arm, he tapped it lightly and said,
"Nay, lad, hang on to your brass. You've spread enough about for one night."
He turned to go, and then stopped and pointed up the road.
"Yon's Mrs. Hewitt, number 8, he said,
indicating a tall, narrow-fronted building with a tiny garden edged by a low brick wall.
"You can tell her Mick Radley sent you, for what it's worth."
He turned and lumbered off, his gait uneven, with the bad arm slung across his chest and his head bent towards the sea wind. Mrs. Hewitt proved to be a tall, thin body, whose air of cultured haughtiness appeared a professional stance, like the woven mat that said welcome on her scrubbed doorstep and the white lace half-curtains on her windows. It was part of the role. "Yes," she said, narrowing the vowel delicately. "Can I help you?"
"I was looking for a room," he said, adding quickly, "Mr. Radley suggested I try her."
"Mr. Radley?"
"Mick Radley. He said I should say..."
"Indeed."
She eyed him as frostily as ever, but something in her voice had softened.
"I'm very much afraid my best rooms are all taken. I'm much in demand, you know. However, we might be able to find you a small accommodation for a week, while we get to know each other," she added darkly. "Then we shall reassess."
"A week would do splendidly," he assured her rapidly,
lifting his suitcase as she stepped backwards into the hallway to let him in. He was still carrying the sign, and tried now to conceal it against the sleeve of his greatcoat, knowing it would be difficult to explain. She led him up 2 flights of narrow, dark stairs,
hung at fiercely irregular intervals with small, sentimental seaside prints. At the second landing, she stepped towards the back of the house and opened a white panelled door. The room within, shabby in the dull grey of an overhead light, looked out onto a courtyard, which revealed itself now only as a rectangle of black night bordered by thin pink curtains. She crossed to the window, tugged the curtains closed, and indicated the bed, wardrobe, washbasin, and small easy chair with a wave of one thin, beringed hand. On the floor, an ancient square of carpet in mock Persian design covered the centre of the room, revealing darkly varnished floorboards at the perimeters. A small electric fire sat on the disused tiled hearth, its cord connected to a solid metal meter.
"Breakfast at 7, tea at 5:30. I'll need your ration book, of course. Tariff, £5 per week, in advance."
He was standing yet, looking bravely about the dismal room, trying to generate a homely warmth by force of will.
"In advance, mister."
"Yes, of course," he said hastily, reaching for his wallet. He withdrew a second fiver. One remained within the leather billfold. He extended it to Mrs. Hewitt and realised she was extending her hand vertically as if to shake his. Quickly, he transferred the money to his left and shook her hand with his right. Her fingers were dry and cold. She smiled very slightly and said,
"Jean Hewitt, mister."
He looked at her blankly, as one searching for what to say. He cradled the old wooden sign closer, and then, speaking hesitantly, he said,
"Hardacre. Sam Hardacre."
She paused, her cold hand still in his, and bent her head back slightly.
"Mr. Hardacre," she said. "Sam Hardacre."
"Yes," he said quickly, with more assurance. "Sam Hardacre."
"Interesting," she said. "That's a well-known name in these parts, you know."
"Yes," he said with a sudden nervous grin. "So I've been told."
Chapter 2. The bright red MG TC Roadster roared down the narrow Driffield Road, scattering dry leaves in the November wind. Despite the month, the driver, a woman in a red headscarf that exactly matched the livery of her motor car, had lowered the hood and the wind whipped up strands of curling dark hair from beneath the scarf, blowing them forward over her face. She was a pretty woman in her late 40s, her creamy French complexion only slightly marked by delicate and expressive lines of age. Her brow was furrowed in thought, or perhaps concentration, as the little car nipped happily round the stone-walled curves. At the big black iron gates of a great country house, the car skidded into a turn and roared off up the gravel drive. Madeleine Bisset Hardacre was coming to tea. Madeleine jammed her foot down impatiently. The drive was always longer than one thought, winding at least a half mile through tall elms and then a beech wood, before one even glimpsed the house at all. It was scenic, and such driveways no doubt added to the dramatic impact of the mansion when at last it was sighted, but it was a tremendous nuisance if one was in a hurry. Madeleine was always in a hurry. Today she was even more in a hurry than usual. The drive turned and dipped, and Madeleine, cornering hard, was confronted with a sudden splash of glorious moving colour in the centre of the roadway. She hit her brakes, skidding on gravel, and felt the rear wheels break free and come around. More angry than frightened, she swung the wheel into the skid, overcorrected, swung the other way, and slid, almost sedately, into the ditch. For a moment she sat quite still, her hands on the wheel. Then she carefully patted her face, adjusted her clothing, checked that her feeling of being physically unharmed was not an illusion. After another moment, she was convinced that the only damage sustained was a small ladder in her left stocking, caused by the heel of her right shoe. She switched off the ignition and turned to open her door, awkwardly heavy since the roadster was tilted at a definite angle to the left. As she turned, she came face to face with a large, scaly, beady-eyed head, and she screamed. The head jerked back like a frightened chicken's. "Zut," said Madeleine, pursing her lips and reverting to Gallic temper, as always in times of stress. She was staring eyeball to eyeball with a peacock. not just any peacock, but the peacock responsible for her being in a gravelly ditch when she should be arriving to tea. Madeleine abandoned the door and scrambled up onto the leather seat and over the side. She swung a vicious kick of 3-inch heels at the bird, which staggered away with a noise like crackling brushwood as it dragged its heavy, folded tail across the road.
Stupid bird!
She thought of Harry, who treasured the ungainly, glorious thing, and directed a mental kick at his posterior as well.
Stupid Harry, stupid bird!
She walked around the car, inspecting the damage while her temper boiled. It was minimal, but the car was well grounded. Noel would have to come with a tractor and haul it out. Meanwhile, she was later than ever, and faced with the prospect of a further quarter-mile walk in her tottering heels to the house. Madeleine sat gingerly on the bright red right front wing as she pondered what to do. It was not unlikely that, if she simply waited, someone would come along. The driveway being the entrance to a working, if not precisely thriving estate, as well as a family home, must see its share of farm workers, tradesmen, and sociable neighbours in an afternoon. If one could simply be counted on to arrive promptly. Madeleine adjusted her red headscarf and crossed her legs, glancing impatiently at the gold wristwatch Harry had given her for their anniversary. Her eyes lingered, savouring its precise detail and graceful design. The pity of having a lover was that one could never show off one's little trophies as a married woman could. She had told the ladies of her staff that it was the gift of a particularly grateful, wealthy customer, which, of course, only increased their pity for her and fueled their efforts, as perennial as they were useless, to find the widowed Madeleine a husband. Madeleine had been a widow since the Great War. Considering her still striking attractiveness, that time lapse alone should indicate that Madeleine was making her own arrangements. But the ladies of Driffield were not a discerning lot. Madeleine sighed, thinking of them with a faint, amused pity of her own. She knew they would never quite forgive her her connections, albeit by marriage alone to the big house at the end of this gravelled drive. It was called after the family whose name Madeleine Bisset had carried since 1916, Hardacres. Not even Hardacre Hall, but simply the family name itself, aggressive and possessive, with which it had been rechristened on the exact day in the autumn of 1889, when it had been bought from the hereditary owners by the man known throughout the North as the Herring King. The ladies who patronised Madeleine's dress shop and patronised Madeleine called it nothing but the original name, Wotton Manor, as a quiet way of keeping Madeleine firmly in her place. She shrugged, wrapping her neat little fitted jacket tighter against a gust of leaf-swirling wind. Who knows, perhaps they were right. Perhaps they did not trust the Hardacres to establish the sort of dynastic firmness that is needed by those who are to be relied upon to make changes on the local map. Maps weren't drawn often, after all, and in the context of a centuries-old manor house, what were the trifling years from 1889 to 1950? Who was to say the Hardacres would not prove a mere flash in the pan, retreating with barely 60 years hold to leave the place once more in the hands of more traditional wealth? As things looked just now, such a possibility was not at all unlikely. It saddened her deeply. Not for herself. Madeleine, even after all these years, was French to the core, and English tradition meant nothing to her. But for Harry. Harry loved the place passionately, and lived now in genteel poverty to maintain it. And yet Harry must know that if the icy grip of tightening financial straits did not get him, then time itself undoubtedly would. For though Harry Hardacre had bodily heirs, and more than one, he had no spiritual heir. No one in the family regarded the old place as anything other than bricks and mortar, out of date and increasingly comfortless. Harry alone held within him the warm, living soul of Hardacres, and knew it would be extinguished on the day he died. Madeleine stared moodily at the dust-marked toe of her pale beige calf shoe, feeling morose and sad for Harry, to such a degree that she'd almost forgotten her hurry and the reason for it. For the first time since yesterday, when Terry had telephoned, she'd briefly forgotten young Sam. The chastening thought of him flooded back, rekindling her haste. She jumped up and brushed down her swirlingly feminine beige new-look skirt. She would have to walk. She took two determined steps with the peevish stride of one who never ordinarily walks further than from the doorstep to the motor car at the curb. When a distant sound broke through that of the rustling of leaves and squawking of peafowl, a sharp patter of hoofbeats down the gravel drive. "Oh, thank God," Madeleine said, turning to the sound, knowing she was about to be rescued. The horse, a tall bay with what Madeleine, whose tastes ran to fast motor cars and pretty dresses rather than horses, would call black trim, cantered around the bend where Madeleine had met the peacock. The rider, a woman in precisely tailored hacking gear, reined in, and the horse came to a quick, well-disciplined halt and stood puffing steamy breath into the frosty air. The horsewoman was Harry Hardacre's daughter, Vanessa, a large-boned, plain woman devoid of makeup, her shoulder-length, greying brown hair worn straight and usually, as now, tied back tightly beneath a riding hat. She looked puzzled, and her eyes moved slowly from Madeleine in her beige suit and high-heeled pumps to the red MG in the ditch and back to Madeleine. She blinked once in careful assessment.
"Having a spot of bother, old girl," she said.
"I am in this stupid ditch because of your father's idiotic bird, and I'm 15 minutes late already, and it is more than a spot of bother," Madeleine declared.
"Does it still go?"
Vanessa said warily, looking down at the immobile car. She had the same lack of interest in motors as Madeleine had in horses.
"Whether it goes or not is not the point. I'll need Noel and a tractor to get it out, and I must see your father at once."
Vanessa blinked again. Madeleine waited for Vanessa to suggest she ride off for help, but Vanessa was still engrossed in the grounded MG. She appeared to be considering the possibility of having to shoot it.
"Vanessa, I must get to the house. Could you possibly
give you a ride behind?"
"Oh, I don't know. Goldflake is not very keen on doubles. Liable to toss us both," she added cheerfully.
She returned her mournful gaze to the car. Madeleine shook her head. For all the years she had known Harry's daughter, she'd found it impossible to make any point clear to her. Vanessa lived in a world of horses and tack and mucking out and bedding down, and seemed to comprehend nothing else. At times, Madeleine had been most grateful for her obtuseness. At 44, Vanessa, though a married woman and even a mother, had never imagined anything between Madeleine and her father but familial loyalty.
"I have absolutely no desire to ride on that animal," Madeleine said. "If you'd be so kind as to ride up to the house and find Harry with the motor..."
"What a good idea," Vanessa said brightly. "Back in a jiff. Toodaloo, old thing."
She cantered off on her mission of mercy, and Madeleine sat down again on the wing of her MG. She watched the disappearing horsewoman and sighed. Thank God for Rodney, she thought, blessing Vanessa's husband, a man every bit as equinely inclined as Vanessa herself. Surely no one else in all of Yorkshire or England or the world would have married the silly fool. Fortunately for Madeleine, waiting less than patiently amidst the beechwood, Noel Hardacre, Vanessa's elder brother, was at that moment clattering down the drive from the stable square behind the house on his tractor. He met his sister just at the point where the woods gave way to a long, dramatic sweep of lawn that drew the eye unerringly to the vast, square, red-brick mansion at the crest of the hill. Vanessa had no eye for beauty and did not even glance at the majestic display of carefully managed greenery and softly aging brick and stone. She'd lived her entire life at Hardacre's, apart from her school years, of course, and it was utterly mundane to her. It existed for herself and for Rodney only as a spacious background for their equine obsession. There were rooms in the big house that she'd not bothered to enter for years. She reined in Goldflake to a sharp trot and hailed her brother. Noel tipped his head, indicating that he had heard, was annoyed at being asked to listen, and was not stopping anyhow.
"Whoa there!" Vanessa shouted to both her brother and the horse.
She stopped directly in his path and, disgruntled, he stopped as well. She had not forgotten Madeleine's abandonment, but a new thought struck her that was infinitely more important. She saw at once that Noel had the plough attached to the tractor, fierce blades swung up clear of the road.
Where are you going with that? She asked suspiciously, eyeing it.
Bottom field, he said.
Noel, despite his gentle, scholarly father and his public school upbringing, had lived all his life as a Yorkshire farmer, seemingly only happy when physically engrossed in the tough struggle to make the once lavish estate pay for itself. He worked with his hands every day of his life and sought out the company of others who did so as well. As he aged, alone in touchy bachelor eccentricity, his accent coarsened, his dress grew shabbier, and even his face seemed to take on rough lines of his own. A year ago, he had abruptly moved his uninspired belongings right out of the mansion house that he would most likely inherit and installed himself in a farm labourer's cottage on his own estate. It was just one more of his extraordinary and antisocial ways, and at the time hardly caused a ripple of surprise among those who knew him well. Noel was beginning to be regarded by all around as a reet queer un. Vanessa was unimpressed either by his eccentricity or his renowned temper.
And what, may I ask, do you intend to do with it in the bottom field?
Noel screwed up his lean face in a slow, amused grin.
Aye, well, he said, still grinning. Thought this tractor had the makings of a good point-to-pointer. Thought I'd set her at that big hedge Rodney's always putting horses over and see if I can get her to jump.
Noel, Vanessa spluttered, her face reddening. Noel, that is very unfunny. You know very well the hunt uses that field every meet. What are you up to?
The hunt did use it. Tomorrow she'll be my winter wheat.
Winter wheat? Vanessa exclaimed. Since when do we grow winter wheat?
Since tomorrow. Come on now, girl, move that walking glue factory. Some of us have work to do.
Noel, you will not plough up our bottom field. Rodney won't allow it. I won't allow it. I'll see Father. I'll see Father right now.
She turned the horse around in a dancing circle, muttering,
Winter wheat in the bottom field. I've never heard the like.
Father'll allow it, all right,
Noel shouted over the continuing roar of his tractor engine.
Father wants the bills paid.
Ridiculous, Vanessa stormed.
And then, as Noel rumbled off, she remembered Madeleine. She galloped after Noel in triumph.
Besides, you can't plough just now, anyhow.
Can and bloody shall.
No.
Vanessa cut ahead of him again, and he slammed his brake on and lost his temper.
Get that bloody useless beast out of my way or I'll run it down.
You can't plough today because you've got to haul a car out of a ditch, Vanessa gloated.
What bloomin' car? What ditch?
Down there, Vanessa pointed an imperious finger. Madeleine's in the ditch. She paused. She's not very pleased.
Noel stared down the silent, curving driveway.
In the ditch? How the hell...
I think she was trying to miss a peacock, said Vanessa in a small voice.
Noel stared. Then he slammed his fist onto the steering wheel of the tractor and shouted,
Bloody damn women! Bloody damn animals, horses, peacocks! You'd think I was running a bloody zoo!
He thrust the idling machine into gear and, still cursing, clattered off down the long drive. Vanessa gave a smug smile of satisfaction at his enforced detour and whirled Goldflake about and galloped off to her father and the rescue of the bottom field. Harry Hardacre, Vanessa's father and bemusedly unassuming patriarch of the Hardacre family, was at that moment enjoying the special pleasures of a lovely autumn day from the quiet shelter of his favourite room, the oak-panelled, book-lined library. It was a room that, throughout his father's tenure of the house, had remained dustily abandoned, just as it had for the previous decades under the domain of the undoubtedly better-bred but hardly better-read Sir John Wildebor. But when Harry inherited Hardacre's, the library became its heart. From boyhood, books had been his delight, and now, as old age approached, they were his refuge. Harry rose from his chair by the fire and stretched awkwardly, shaking his bad leg, which stiffened always as he sat, and walked with a pronounced limp to the tall window that reached from knee level to near the 12-foot ceiling. Watery, thin sunlight came through, distorted by the natural deformities of the old glass, showing up dusty streaks on the interior of the pane. Harry looked at the streaks ruefully.
They were a reproach, but one to which he was powerless to respond. The two aging village ladies, who, with cook, now comprised the sum total of Hardacre household staff, could hardly be criticised for missing a window. They were, however, Harry would readily admit, precisely all he could afford. His only concern was that in the near future it was not impossible that one of them too might have to go. He put the thought from his mind, not wishing to dwell either on it or its larger implications. He let his eyes stray over the gardens again, his left hand gently caressing the broad depth of wall in the window alcove, feeling comforted by its ancient, luxurious solidity. He glanced up to the high, beautifully moulded ceiling, finding it impossible to regret its graceful height, even though the house was proving daily more difficult to heat. He put that thought too aside and returned his eyes to the lawns, marvelling, as he always did, at how quickly they had recovered from their wartime devastation, when patriotic duty had obliged him to plough them up for corn. He remembered that day as if it were yesterday, himself on the tractor and Hetty and Madeleine watching from the terrace. The thought of Hetty stirred him. He drew out his watch, wondering if he should wake her for tea or let her sleep. He decided on the latter. If he woke her, she would make a brave effort and come down to join them, but by dinner time she would be exhausted. Better those spare few hours in the evening, when they could laugh and talk over their meal and pretend everything was yet as it once was. Hetty, or rather Hetty's failing health, was the one true cloud on Harry's horizon. All other concerns he could, with a practiced talent, shove gently aside, smooth over with happier thoughts. But his wife's slow descent into invalidity was always with him, like the dull bone ache of his crippled leg. In the depths of his heart, Harry Hardacre carried his wife's pain as if it were his own. He could not remember even now when it had begun, at what point Hetty's general listlessness, her numerous unexplained small miseries, had crystallized into real ill health. At times it seemed as if Hetty had always been ill, right from the beginning of their marriage. He could not honestly recall a day since he met her, when first she came to Hardacre's as nanny to his so recently orphaned children, when Hetty had displayed true bodily well-being. It was certainly true that within a year or two of their wedding day, Hetty's complaints, her back, her female problems, her headaches, her nerves, had resulted in a retreat to separate beds. A less honest man than Harry Hardacre might have used that early estrangement as just cause for the long-standing affair with Madeleine, as partial cause it certainly was. But Harry knew he would have loved Madeleine regardless. Indeed, Hetty's health had been, instead, the one firm tie that had brought him hastening back from Madeleine's bed, again and again, on the bowed wings of guilt. He often wondered, had Hetty been tough and strong, as tough and strong as Madeleine, would he have left her and Hardacre's and all that was precious to him for the sake of love? No matter now, he thought. Age had stilled his blood, as Yeats would have it, and now, ironically, he found companionship with both his women, as gentle and loving as if each were his wife. Harry Hardacre, at 72, was in many ways a more contented man than ever before in his life. Unlike poor Hetty, he had his health. Indeed, his health was better than in his boyhood, when his childhood and poverty had taken its toll, and better than in young adulthood, when the Boer War wounds and the heart wound of losing Judith had made him frail before his years. Now, like a thin old tree that had weathered much, he had grown surprisingly supple and resilient, able to take long walks over his estate with the aid of his stick, and to indulge in long nights of study alone into the small hours. He hardly needed to sleep at all anymore, and was delighted with the spare time his wakeful nights allowed him. A few months ago, he had commenced writing a book about his childhood with his itinerant parents and his long-dead brother Joe, just for the pleasure of freezing the past in words. He had managed, over the years since his father's death, to keep both the family and the estate together, no mean feat, and even with finances a constant strain and his mixed bag of Hardacre offspring at odds, he felt, just looking over the green lawns on a November afternoon, a distinct thrill of success. Still, the need for money was a fact that would not go away, no matter how often he sidestepped it, as clear a fact as the undeniable descent of the Hardacre fortunes since the death of Sam Hardacre, the Herring King. How odd, Harry thought, smiling to himself, his hand still caressing the security of the 2-foot-thick wall, that even living in a place like this, one can need to worry about money. When he was a child, moving with his parents from rented room to rented room, or following the herring fleet in the old pony cart, sleeping nights in the countryside under the tarpaulin, he had thought that any human being who actually lived in a house at all was rich as Midas. Even a cowman's cottage, with thatched roof and crumbling chimney stack, was a palace in his boyhood's eye. Now here he was, Harry Hardacre, living in a brick Tudor mansion, and he was one thing his father in all his life had never been. He was in debt. Harry sighed and decided to use one of the few rich man's prerogatives left to him. He went to the old-fashioned velvet bell pull by the fireplace and rang for tea. Even if it was only Mrs. Bennet up from Driffield for the afternoon, she would bring a silver tray laden with the Crown Derby servers, and when Madeline arrived, they would sit before the fire and talk about the past and the future and the family, as if nothing ever would change. Thinking of Madeline, he glanced again at his watch, saw that she was even later than usual, and set to wondering again what the urgent matter was that she'd refused to discuss in her telephone call earlier in the day. It must truly be urgent, too, or else she would not have come to the house at all. Usually they met in Driffield where she kept her shop, or he went to her in her little cottage on the fringe of the Hardacre estate. As Hetty failed, Madeline withdrew. She had a great sense of justice and would not intrude upon a fallen opponent. Harry strolled across to his desk, piled high with papers, as always, and found his eye unerringly making for the stack of unpaid bills. He shuffled them wryly and then let them fall with a soft sighing to the dusty leather servers. Mentally, he made another appointment with the bank manager, and mentally he broke it. "The trouble with you Hardacres," the bank manager, a blunt man, had said, "is you're all too good at spending money, and the only one of you any damn use at making it was old Sam." Harry wasn't offended. It was precisely the truth, a truth he had recognized long ago. Therein lay the source of the Hardacre dilemma. Sam Hardacre had begun his working life gutting herring on the Yorkshire fish quays. With wit and ingenuity and a tiny touch of sheer luck, he had moved from gutting fish to selling cooked herring at the racetracks, to owning cafes, and then owning almost every growing business in sight, hotels, railways, cotton mills. He was a young man in a country full of young, untrammelled industry. Britain in the 1880s, a country with fortunes to be made, crying out to be made. And Sam had all it took to make one. And then, Harry thought with a smile, he spawned a family as useless in that respect as Sam himself was talented. Except for Joe, of course, Harry corrected a little painfully. His brother Joe could make money. Whatever his faults, that wasn't one of them. But Joe had got caught up in a different kind of country, a different kind of business, the frenetic world of paper money of the New York Stock Exchange. Joe got caught up and carried away, spiraling up and up to the vertiginous heights from which, with so many others, he came crashing down on a day in 1929. Joe Hardacre died in a bloody mess on a New York pavement, an ending that, to this day, his brother Harry found impossible to think about. But Joe aside, there wasn't a one of them fit to stand in Sam Hardacre's shoes. Nor was there, ironically, room any longer in the Britain of 1950 for a man to step the length of Sam Hardacre's stride. From boyhood, Harry had known that he himself would never be his father's heir. Even when his inheritance was only a fought-for stance on the fish quays, Harry knew that Joe was his father's son. Tough, independent, fierce if necessary, though Joe, God help him, had always lacked old Sam's inherent decency. But Harry was his mother's child, a gentle, contemplative person who rose to challenges of the intellect, not the body. He was no coward and no weakling, having distinguished himself in his brief military career. but he was no fighter either, and Sam's world had been a fighter's world. Harry had sheltered serenely in the backwater of the role of second son, until, of course, Joe's suicide thrust him unwillingly to the fore. Since that day, he had done the only thing he could do. He had conserved. But conservation, he was beginning to discover, was a fool's paradise, as his son Noel was always quick to point out. Harry did not mind that life, and changing fortunes made it impossible to advance. He had no wish to advance. What he did wryly resent was that there was no way in the tumultuous, inflationary world of post-war Britain simply to stand still. Death duties, rising taxation, rates, fuel costs and wages all chipped away at his fortune. Harry was left like a seaside child with his sandcastle under siege by the tide. Harry thought it distinctly odd, if not downright unfair, that none of all the family had inherited the financial genius of his father, but it appeared none had. Of the original family, there was only himself and his younger sister Jane left, of course. Jane had done her best, actually, Harry thought with a smile, at least in the terms that their Edwardian coming of age had allowed. Jane had married money, old money too, and a title, becoming the wife of the heir to the MacGregor of Strathconnon. But Jane's husband, Ian, had died at sea in the First War. Peter, the son of her brief marriage, died in the Eyre in the Second. The title and estate had passed to distant cousins, and though Jane was well provided for and even maintained a house in Strathconnon, yet the Hardacre connections with Scottish wealth were more or less severed. In fact, two wars had dealt harshly with all the family, so much so that they had become a microcosm of the nation itself, which had by the end of the first half of the century lost so much of its wealth, territory and human potential to violent history. In fact, Harry thought, warming to the premise, it was quite possible that the wars between them really offered the answer to the decline of his family. What might have happened had Jane's son Peter lived, or if Joe's son Arnold had survived the 1914-18 conflict and taken his young French wife onto his father's business world instead of leaving her behind, a widow at 17. Harry scratched his head ruefully, recalling the long-ago entrance of the lovely, black-clad young Frenchwoman into his household and his life. It would have made his own life, and Hetty's very different, no doubt. Harry was sure the key lay with Arnold, for Joe's two daughters, Maud and Emily, had taken their own ways in life, and neither way had led to real money. Emily had married the detective Philip Barton, and had led, until this year, a solid middle-class existence as he rose through the ranks of the London police. Until, that was, Barton had taken this mad idea of owning a pub and had moved his protesting family, lock, stock and London accents, to the Rose at Killam. Maud's marriage had at first promised even less financially than Emily's, when she'd wed the father of her illegitimate daughter a year after the young lady's birth. Albert Chandler was then a hard-working, hard-up trumpet player, with as uncertain a future as possible. That had not stopped the artistic and romantic Maud, and for once the Hardacre luck held. Albert was in Hollywood now, with Maud and their daughter Janet, and though none of his film compositions had quite touched the heights of Theme for a Lonely Woman, there was hardly a major film made these days that didn't find his name on the credits somewhere. But that was nothing compared to his daughter, of whom he was, in his letters, understandably proud. Janet Chandler was exactly 24 by Harry's information, although by Hollywood's she was 19 for the third year running, and in her latest film, Destiny's Daughter, her name was above the title. The film had amused Harry no end. Sam's great-granddaughter with platinum hair and glowing lips played a resistance heroine in wartime France, the poor child of a Breton fisherman. Still, Janet Chandler's almost unreal wealth would be of little use to Hardacres. It was a place she'd last seen 22 years ago at the age of 2, when she'd been singularly unimpressed. No, Joe's daughters would not provide the Hardacre heir, nor, most certainly, would his own. Vanessa was the chief sinner his bank manager had in mind. She'd been shoveling Hardacre money down equine gullets for the past 10 years, with the able help of Rodney, her husband.
The grey contingent came down heavily on the debit side of the book. And then there was Noel. Noel was the true enigma of the family. He had energy, toughness, an unimaginable capacity for hard work, untrammelled by the slightest trace of, say, Maud's romanticism, Harry's own conservatism, Vanessa's dim county pretensions, or the slightest touch of sentiment at all. Far from having to cry out for practicality, as Harry forever was obliged to with Vanessa, with Noel he had to take constant blocking action, or else Noel's ruthless practicality would have wiped every trace of dignity and beauty from the face of both house and land. Harry personally felt that Noel was never happier than during the war, when the national emergency enabled him to take progressive and destructive steps that peacetime would never allow. It was then, tearing out the centuries-old yew hedge, sowing the grand sweep of lawns and corn, turning Mary Hardacre's treasured grey barbers into impromptu chicken runs, that Noel had excelled. Hardacre's to Noel was not a treasure but an adversary. He did not husband it, but raped it at every chance. Only Harry, hemmed in by debts, stood between Hardacre's and Noel's full, brutal intent. And yet Noel, and Noel alone, kept it running and made it grudgingly and only just pay. Even were Noel not his son, Harry knew he would never give in to the terrible temptation to send him packing. Hardacre's needed Noel as it needed no one else, and like a battered wife, it must cling to him to the end. And yet Noel, Hardacre's grudging saviour, had brought about the one disaster that would, inevitably, Harry was sure, lead to its destruction. For 6 months ago, Harry had made the first, only financial coup of his life, a stroke of his father's wily genius descending in solitary splendour on his modest second son, as effective as it was uncharacteristic. And Noel, God damn his feisty temper, had in one moment tossed it away, and with it, their financial salvation. Hardacre's was a unique house. It stood in Yorkshire where great houses were built of stone, and it had, for reasons lost in Tudor antiquity, been built in red brick. There wasn't another like it in the county. Artistically, that was no great loss. It was not and never had been a pretty house. It was square, massive, flat-roofed, graceless. Windows trimmed in sandstone were set in regimented orderly rows, like fussy buttons on a spinster's frock. The roof was festooned in chimney pots and circled by an illogical sandstone balustrade. It stood out on an artificially enhanced small natural rise, like a big square brooding hen. But it had stood there for hundreds of years, while history rolled serenely by, and Yorkshire winds and rain had weathered it to a soft colour, impossible for man alone to create. An old tree had grown around it and fallen and regrown. It was as impossible to recreate, once destroyed, as an aged oak tree, and inspired the same mortal awe. And in the late summer of 1949, Harry Hardacre quietly let it be known that he intended to tear it down. Anyone who even remotely knew Harry would instantly take this announced intention for the bold lie that it was. But the officials of the National Trust didn't know Harry from Adam. They did know he was the son of a Yorkshire herring gutter, and drew their own ready conclusions about new money. Whereupon they promptly marched up to Hardacre's, alias Wotton Manor by Great Driffield, and confronted the Philistine in his den, wherein Harry Hardacre gave the sole theatrical performance of his life, a performance of such stunning veracity that the representatives of the Trust genuinely believed they were facing a heartless heathen who would shortly reduce the place to a massive heap of used brick and promptly build a bungalow on top. They argued. Harry pleaded poverty. They withdrew. Upon their return, they made Harry an offer. The Trust would take over and maintain the property, allowing him and his immediate family the use of the West Wing in perpetuity. In return, Harry would stay execution. Harry dithered, hemmed and hawed, and at last, graciously, over a glass of Madeira, allowed himself to be thrown in the briar patch. It was a masterwork, of which his father would have been justly proud. And then Noel bought his Neeson hut. It was, in its way, the ultimate Noel purchase.
He got it for next to nothing, at a military surplus sale at the nearby and now disused wartime aerodrome of Hutton Granswick. Not only that, but he managed to persuade a fellow purchaser to load the dismantled structure onto his own newly purchased army lorry and cart it to Hardacre's, all for the price of a couple of pints. Proudly, Noel returned homeward in his pre-war Vauxhall, tailing the lorry like a happy sheepdog. The whole procession arrived at Hardacre's almost simultaneously with a clutch of National Trust officials and solicitors, all about to attend the final meeting with Harry Hardacre, at which all necessary papers regarding the transfer of title deeds would be signed. Unbelieving, they gathered in a wide-eyed pinstripe circle as Noel unloaded his treasure directly in front of the house. To be fair to Noel, he did not actually intend to keep it there. It was destined for the back of the stable yard, where it would become an instantaneous feed store, and the bargain of the year at that. But he was also genuinely very proud of it. He had saved a lot of money and got himself a tidy, little much-needed feed store. He was fond of it. Noel was like that. He took fancies to things and had favourites among his tools, his vehicles, his various farm structures. It was his pet, and now it was surrounded by a circle of citified dandies poking fingers at it and maligning it with well-bred, narrow-voweled tongues. It was late, he was tired, and, deep in his heart, the sight of his father surrounded by the mockers of his new treasure was a little too much. Noel lost his rag. Noel's temper was legendary through the pubs and auction rings and all farm gatherings of the north. He had thrown erstwhile companions through windows in his younger days and was still known to fly into a towering rage at market if a favoured beast failed to make its price. Now Harry's little cluster of trust members and solicitors got their first view of it. Noel raged, told them to get their hands off his property and their feet off it as well. He was huffily told the property was imminently theirs, and while things were being got off it, he could start with his prefabricated abomination. Whereupon Noel announced the deal was off. Harry intervened in desperation. Noel threatened physical violence, and a solicitor offered to telephone the local constabulary. Noel said he needn't bother since they were all just leaving anyhow, weren't they? An unfortunate trust member suggested it might be wise if they withdrew for consideration, taking their documents with them. Whether it was a genuine move or a threat, Harry never knew. Noel took it as a threat, which toppled what was left of his limited restraint. He suggested that the documents be rolled up tight and stored by the trust member in an unconventional place. The delegation withdrew, quietly and for good. Harry was left alone in the placid spring sunshine, watching Noel construct his Neeson hut with delighted relish and counting the ultimate cost of that extravagant afternoon as the shadows of the great beech trees crept inexorably closer and evening descended on his great brick house. One day, he knew, that battered RAF prefab would prove to be the most expensive Neeson hut in the world. Oddly, he forgave Noel at once. Something in his mindless attachment to his tin treasure reminded Harry of himself, clinging as desperately to 3 floors and 40 rooms of aging brick. They would go down together, his son and he, Hardacres both in their separate ways. And unless the most unlikely occurred, and his bachelor son decided at this late date and nearing 50 to wed, their going down would be the end of it. There was no one left beyond them to carry the Hardacre name. Except, of course, Sam and Terry, but their brand of bachelorhood was, unlike Noel's, no casual accident. And more even than Noel's, theirs was for keeps, which, as far as the family was concerned, was more of a loss, Harry knew, than Noel. For they, Sam and Terry Bisset Hardacre, twin sons of Madeleine and Arnold's fleeting wartime marriage, had always, in his mind, been the future. They alone carried the Hardacre name into the present generation. They alone, grandsons of his determined brother Joe, had within them the old verve and inventiveness and reckless courage that the rest of the family had lost. They were Sam's heirs in this world, if anyone was, and they, lively, bright, social, extroverted troublemakers throughout their youth, had, in early manhood, turned their backs on the world entirely. The Hardacre twins, famed through school for audacious pranks, through their army careers for outlandish devilment, and no small degree of high living, the charmers of the family and its favourite rogues had, at the age of 30, followed their mother's Catholic faith to its ultimate conclusion. Side by side, as they had done everything throughout their twinned lives, they entered the Benedictine Abbey of Ampleforth and left all worldly inheritance behind. It was a turnabout that was, to this day, beyond Harry's comprehension. Harry had accompanied Madeleine to Ampleforth on that day. Hetty had refused to attend, not because of any resentment of Madeleine, but because the occasion was Roman Catholic, and Hetty's deep, wary distrust of Rome was the one remnant of her Yorkshire country background she could never shake. Madeleine had wept in a mixture of pride that her sons had given themselves to the church, and sorrow over the lost hopes of grandchildren. And Harry, watching, said goodbye to Sam Hardacre's brief dream of dynasty. It was over. Two wars and half a century later, the family of the Herring King was nearing its end. A soft, gravelly sound of horses' hooves outside the window caused Harry to raise his head from his paper-strewn desk. Vanessa rode by the window at a brisk, determined trot, and a moment later he heard her authoritative, "Whoa up!" followed rapidly by the clatter of the big outer front door and the solid click of riding boots on the tiled entranceway. "Father!" she was shouting, even as she strode down the hallway, colliding in the library doorway with Mrs. Bennet, who had come in answer to his bell. Mrs. Bennet attempted to duck and scuttle rabbit-like away, as she always did when confronted by Vanessa, of whom, for no logical reason, she was afraid.
"Just tea, Mrs. Bennet, please, when Mrs. Hardacre arrives."
"I can't possibly stay, Father," Vanessa interrupted, unaware that she hadn't been invited.
"For two, then, Mrs. Bennet," Harry said with relief.
"Father, the most outrageous thing has occurred," Vanessa continued, still panting from her ride and her now full-blown indignation. "The most unbelievable, outrageous thing."
"And what would that be?" Harry asked mildly, knowing it could be anything from a social gaffe by some member of the hunt to another world war. Vanessa lacked proportion.
"It's a travesty," Vanessa went on. "A positive travesty. The consequences would be sheer disaster. Disaster."
She shook her head, alarmed at her own thoughts, untying her blunt-cut hair and ruffling distraught fingers through its length.
"Consequences of what, my dear?" Harry asked, still mildly fumbling for his pipe. "And by the way, have you seen Madeleine? She's late."
"I frankly doubt Rodney and I could possibly go on. We might as well write off the winter's meets right now. Just write them off. Tragic for Rod, of course, and a complete disaster for Mary."
Mary was Vanessa and Rodney's 5-year-old daughter, and the entrance of her name into the catalogue of sufferers intrigued Harry to repeat.
"What, my dear? Consequences of what?"
To which Vanessa replied only darkly,
"Noel."
"Ah, Noel."
Harry was getting the picture. He found his tobacco pouch, unfolded it, and plumbed its damp, sweet-smelling depths with practiced fingers.
"You haven't seen Madeleine?" he asked again.
"Madeleine?" Vanessa looked blank. "Of course I've seen her. She's in the ditch."
Her tone of dismissive boredom seemed to indicate that the ditch was Madeleine's natural habitat.
"Where?" Harry shouted, instantly alert. "How? Has she had a smash? Is she all right?"
Vanessa blinked, looking surprised at his excitement, and said in an ordinary voice,
"Of course she's all right. Do you think I'd be standing here if she wasn't?"
Harry thought solemnly for a moment and said,
"In your case, I'm just not sure. Why didn't you tell me she was in trouble? I'll go down for her right now."
"You needn't bother. I've sent Noel on the tractor to haul her out. Everything is quite under control. You see, I am quite responsible," she added miffily.
"I'm sorry, pet," Harry soothed. "I was just rather taken by surprise. Concerned."
He tried to bury his worries over Madeleine.
"Now, tell me, what's the trouble with Noel?"
At that instant, there was a heavy thud on the closed door of the library as a fist was slammed against it and a voice growled,
"That's right, baby sister. Talk about me behind my back.
The door swung open, and Noel, in his customary plus fours and straw-covered tweed jacket, stood glowering under his shock of grey hair at his father and sister at once.
"What's she been telling you while I had my back turned, eh?"
"And why not? You'd plough up my bottom field behind my back, so why shouldn't I talk behind yours?"
"So it's your bottom field now, is it? Just when did you get the title deeds? Or have we turned the whole damned place over to your chinless pink-coated wonders for once and all?" "Where's Madeline, Noel?" Harry pleaded, trying vainly to get the attention of either of his children.
The door to the library, slammed behind him by Noel, once more swung, this time more sedately, open.
"Madeleine is here," Madeleine announced, her voice delicate to the dangerous point of fury, as well Harry knew.
He hastened across the room, extending his arms to her instinctively.
"My dear, you are not hurt?"
"Hurt? No. Angry, annoyed, humiliated, yes." She glowered at Noel. "Thanks to your foolish peacock and both your charming children. That one," she waved a dismissive hand at Vanessa, "leaves me waiting half an hour in the ditch, and that one," she indicated Noel, "hauls me out without so much as a word and tears off in his smelly tractor without waiting even to see if the engine will start."
"Well," Noel said sourly, "it started, or else you wouldn't be here."
"So who should know that it would start or that it would not start, or go on fire or blow up and blow me to smithereens?" Madeleine shouted. "You could have waited a minute of your precious time."
"To be harangued by two women in one day? No thanks. Engines don't blow people to smithereens, Madeleine. Shotguns do that," he added, glowering again at Vanessa. "What have you said?" he demanded again, suspiciously.
"Only the truth."
"And what is that?"
"That if you plough up the bottom field, the hunt will never meet at Hardacre's again, and the last little touch of what all of us have stood for will be gone. Over. Finished. We might as well just pack up and leave."
"What a splendid idea," said Noel.
And Vanessa dissolved incongruously in tears. It was a tactic she'd employed at intervals throughout her life, usually to save some favoured pony from sale, or conversely, lure Harry into yet another auction ring folly. Noel was unimpressed. Harry lit his pipe, hobbled to his fireside chair, and motioned to Madeleine to take the other. She hesitated, moved slightly towards him, and stopped. For the first time, he noticed how pale she was, and how her delicately coloured lips were set so tight that an unaccustomed narrow age line appeared on either side of her slender nose. He saw her glance at his squabbling middle-aged children and knew she wanted to be alone with him. Searching for the most graceful words to achieve that effect, he only managed to utter,
"I don't believe the children will be waiting for tea."
"On the contrary, Father, I feel the need of a cup very badly now," Vanessa sniffed as Mrs. Bennet entered with the tray.
She hastened off for additional china, and Madeleine suddenly sank into the chair by the fire, shook her head once at the hopeless intrusion of people all around her, and buried her face in her hands as she too broke into tears. Harry clambered astonished to his feet, crossing the fireside to stand beside her. Madeleine's tears, an almost unheard of rarity, were as genuine as Vanessa's were false.
"My dear, what is it? Were you hurt?"
"Not me," she sobbed. "It is not me."
"But what?"
"It's Sam," she cried,
shaking her head as Vanessa and Noel turned to stare.
"Sam," Harry said, startled. "Surely Sam's not ill."
The thought was incomprehensible. The twins were health and fitness personified, joint coaches of the Ampleforth school rugby team.
"No," Madeleine sobbed. "Not ill. He's gone. Sam's gone. Terry telephoned last night. Sam's left."
"Sam left Ampleforth," Harry said. "But where?"
"No one knows. He's just gone. He told the abbot some months ago and Terry yesterday morning. And he left like that alone. Oh, Harry, where will he go?"
There was a silence in which Vanessa stopped sniffing, realizing she'd totally lost her audience. Then Noel said,
"Where will he go? Here, of course. Where else? And that's all I bloody need. A bolting monk. A bolting bloody monk!
He turned on his heel and stormed out, slamming the ill-used library door once more. Chapter 3 Sam did not return to Hardacre's. Noel had misjudged him and later grudgingly admitted so. They had all misjudged him. Whatever his reasons for leaving, whatever his plans for the future, they did not include landing himself as either a financial or emotional burden on Noel, Harry, or any member of the family. Whatever he was doing alone. Madeleine, with Harry accompanying her for moral support, motored to Ampleforth, where a long, kindly discussion with the abbot and a further long discussion with Sam's twin, Terry, did little to clarify the situation, although both managed in some way to ease her anxiety. The abbot assured her that Sam's departure was amicable, the result of their mutual careful conclusion that the life of Brother Jude of the Order of St. Benedict was not, after all, for him.
He found he did not truly have a vocation, the abbot said simply. Many have found the same. That is what these first years are for. Still, they are not wasted years, but years of discovery. Now we will see to what use he puts them.
He had smiled, offered sherry, and then left them alone in the guest room with Terry. Terry, or more correctly, Brother Erkenwald, OSB, looked remarkably sedate in Harry's eyes and his flowing black habit, slowly turned his gaze from his mother to his great-uncle and back to his mother. Then, with an expression reminiscent of the many times throughout their childhood when his brother had escaped unscathed from some mutual prank and left him holding the baby, he shrugged and grinned wryly. Apparently Sam, with whom he had shared every secret from infancy, had kept totally to himself and the abbot his momentous decision.
He said, I'm going. I said, where? I thought he meant the pub or something. I just couldn't believe it. For a moment, you see, I wanted to go too. That's why he didn't tell me, you know, until he was ready to leave. It took all his nerve to do something without me, and he knew I'd be the same. I still feel amputated. I keep talking to walls and expecting them to be Sam. It's like during the war when I was in the bag. It's bloody awful being a twin sometimes, you know.
He paused and sipped at the glass of sherry the abbot had provided and looked out of the window at the boys of the school on the playing field below.
Still, it has its compensations. You needn't worry about him, Mother. He's quite all right. You understand?
He touched one finger lightly to the side of his forehead, a gesture that somehow evoked the uncanny communication the twins had always, like many twins, shared.
I'll let you know if anything goes wrong.
He grinned at Harry, and Harry was uncertain if he was joking or not.
I do not understand. I do not forgive, Madeleine said slowly. That he did not let us know. Why did he not contact me? That was so unkind.
Because he knew I would, Terry said logically. It's very hard, you must understand. It's rather like a divorce, I would imagine. Makes it terribly hard to face the family at first. He will, when he is quite sure. When he is sure enough that nothing can change his mind.
A week of silence followed. Madeleine went about her work and her daily life in a state of suppressed nerves that only revealed themselves when the telephone rang and she leapt for it demonically. It was never Sam. Harry, who did telephone regularly, reassured her each time that Terry was no doubt right and her errant son would make contact as soon as his mental state allowed, a viewpoint that Madeleine found far from comforting. Harry himself, still convinced that Sam would turn up at Hardacre's, jumped up at the sound of every arriving vehicle, and Noel, with less friendly intent, cast each one a baleful glare until it vindicated itself by not producing the prodigal brother. So it was that when, late on the following Friday afternoon, a large black taxi, followed directly by a blank-sided workman's van, pulled up in front of the main entrance, the entire resident family came instantly to attention. Harry, who'd been enjoying a quiet glass of sherry with Hetty before Rodney and Vanessa joined them for dinner, hobbled quickly to the window and was joined there by his wife. Both leaned forward, pressing anxious faces against the glass. Vanessa and her husband had just appeared from behind the house, and both, dressed alike in jodhpurs and hacking jackets, also stopped in their tracks and stared.
Noel, who had just arrived back from Driffield with a load of feed sacks in the shooting break, clambered out of that venerable vehicle and began striding purposefully towards the arrival, brows lowering ominously as he approached. The door of the taxi opened slowly, distractedly, as someone inside made some arrangement with the driver. Then a tall figure stepped down, tall, rangy, and unmistakably wearing a skirt. The woman straightened her back, smoothed the stray strand of dark grey hair into the bun at the nape of her neck, and came face to face with Noel, who hadn't had time to change his expression. "My dear, don't look so frightfully appalled," she said with a faint smile. "I'm not staying or anything gruesome like that." Noel's dour face broke into a wide grin, and he extended one work-grimed hand.
"Jane, how delightful. We didn't expect you at all."
He was still grinning as Jane looked around her at the circle of staring faces, both in and out of the house. "So I gather," she said.
"No, please," Noel continued,
relief over his respite from Sam bringing out a totally uncharacteristic desire to make social amends.
"You must forgive us, but we're rather at loose ends around here. We were more or less expecting someone else. Sort of."
He tugged at a lank strand of his thinning hair, looking over his shoulder for help from his father, who was emerging from the front door. "Yes," Jane said, turning to greet her brother. "And something tells me I can guess just who that might be." Quickly, she embraced Harry, exchanging two affectionate cheek kisses. Lady MacGregor was a woman of 60, a woman whom life, rich in experience and not without considerable misfortune, had sculpted to a point of high perfection, so that on the border of old age she was genuinely beautiful. Jane was the only one of Sam and Mary Hardacre's three children to be totally at home in the world of the establishment. She alone had been born to it. Harry and his older brother Joe had each known the full depths of their parents' early poverty, and each had watched Sam Hardacre's extraordinary rise from the fish keys to country squiredom. Neither to Joe nor to Harry would Hardacre's ever be anything but an extraordinary place, a fairy tale handed them in their adolescence. To Jane, it was simply home. She had been born there, like innumerable other well-born ladies of earlier times, had played about its vast gardens in childhood, and been sent out well-prepared into an elegant world from its doors. If her marriage to the future Lord MacGregor had delighted and stunned her family, and perhaps outraged their detractors, to Jane it was only natural. Ian MacGregor was precisely the sort of young man she'd been schooled to expect, and she made him, in their few years, an excellent wife, as comfortable at his side as her mother had been at the side of Sam Hardacre the Gutty. As a girl, she had not been beautiful. She had inherited too much from her father for that, but was always thought attractive. Her strong-boned, honest face and her direct blue eyes, surmounted by well-groomed, luxuriant dark hair, glowed with character. Jane had enough tragedy in her life to have justified a retreat and a sorrowful mourning. But too strong for that, she rose above it all in time, and that character strengthened in her face until now, a tall, gaunt, handsome woman with a ready, humorous smile, she caught and held the attention of anyone she wished. In the years of her early widowhood, women did not remarry, but later, after her son was grown and he too died in another war, there were offers of marriage, often from gentlemen of considerable standing. Jane turned them all down, good-naturedly but firmly. That part of her life was done, she would say, and she knew, even if others did not, when to let go of the things of youth. Perhaps for that reason, Jane MacGregor had a tremendous affinity with the young, and her small house on the MacGregor estate was often filled with young friends, many of them the children and even grandchildren of her own contemporaries. Among the Hardacres, she had fond friendships with Vanessa and Rodney's little daughter, Mary Gray, and also with all three of her niece Emily Barton's young children, Ruth, Olive, and Paul. Most family visits ended with Jane playing cards or billiards, or listening to modern dance music with the young, while her own generation were abandoned to their solemn adult state. Before she would enter the house, Jane asked that her taxi driver and the driver of the hired van be taken into the kitchens for a cup of tea, as she would be needing their services quite shortly, and saw no reason why they shouldn't enjoy some refreshment while they waited.
"Of course," Harry said, taking her arm. "But surely you'll be staying for dinner?"
"No, on the contrary, I will be staying 15 minutes. Oh, don't look so relieved, Noel. It's most ungracious," she added with another grin. Noel appeared genuinely dismayed and said,
"Oh, please, Aunt Jane, do stay. Honestly, I'd like nothing better. I'll even change my shirt."
"For that miracle, I could almost be persuaded," she replied. "But I really can't wait. I've promised Emily that I'll be in Killam by 5. I can assure you we have a great deal of work to do this weekend. A great deal. Philip is out of his mind."
Hetty had appeared at the door in her customary tweed skirt and cardigan buttoned to the neck. She wore thick grey stockings and bedroom slippers of tartan wool. Jane sighed slightly at the sight of her, a sight that had less to do with Hetty's ill health than Hetty's dreary manner of dress. In Jane's view, feeling hellish was no justification for looking hellish, and that, she was sorry, was that.
"Jane, dear, how lovely," Hetty murmured, extending woolly arms. Jane leaned forward for the customary kiss, feeling guilty about her recent thoughts because Hetty did look dreadfully pale and grey.
"What's brought you here?"
"A mission of mercy," Jane said as they entered the drawing room, with Harry trailing and Rodney and Vanessa clumping along behind in their riding boots. Harry set about pouring drinks and Jane continued.
"I had a desperate telephone call from Emily. They had just arrived at this wondrous purchase of Philip's after motoring for hours in the pouring rain, and she discovered that, wonder of wonders, he bought the place without ever looking at the upstairs."
"Surely never," Rodney said.
He was a tall, bald man of near Jane's own age, considerably older than his wife, and his conversation, when not about horses, tended to such admonishments and little else. Rodney appeared permanently amazed by the world outside his stable yard, a place of heathens and madness.
"I'm afraid so," Jane said briskly. "The roof was leaking, 2 ceilings were down, and none of the rooms had been decorated since the First War. Apparently, Philip fell in love with the bar, checked it was stocked well, and left it at that. So there they are, ready to open to an eager public in a fortnight's time. May heaven help them. I told Emily I'd come down via Edinburgh, drop into Jenner's for curtains, take the next train to York for the wallpaper, and, well, here I am. What you see in that splendid little blue van out there is the entire interior of the Rose at Killam. Prefab, so to speak."
"Jane, you are awfully brave," Hetty said in hesitant admiration.
"I'm awfully thick, if you ask me," Jane dismissed. "Still, I couldn't leave them floundering. And I am quite capable. I've just finished 4 bedrooms in the new inn for Heidi in Strathconnon."
Harry nodded. He had evidence of Jane's ability himself. Last year, she'd quietly saved him a considerable amount of money by redecorating the entire upstairs of Hardacre's single-handed. He had never yet met a task of which she was not, if required, totally capable. During the war, she'd driven tractors on the farm with cheerful, inventive glee. For the one Hardacre born never needing to work, she was remarkably adept at all manner of it.
"How kind of you to stop in to see us," Hetty murmured, adjusting her footstool in front of the fire. "When you were so busy, after all."
"Oh, I'm afraid this isn't exactly social, my dears," Jane said at once. "I have a message to deliver, you see, or else I'm rather afraid I'd have given you all amiss." She grinned again. "Do tell, Madeleine isn't by chance around."
She waited while the roomful of her relatives made their customary little silence whenever Madeleine's name was mentioned in Hetty's presence. Jane was the only member of the family, other than the naive Vanessa, who refused to indulge in this little hypocrisy, feeling as she did that Hetty had by now surely come to terms with the situation, indeed perhaps finding it in some ways to her advantage. It did, Jane was well aware, rather do away with that nagging question of bed.
"Oh, Madeleine," Rodney said blankly,
as if he'd just remembered who she was.
"I say, Jane, haven't you heard?" Vanessa blurted in her embarrassingly imperceptive way.
"Heard what?"
"About Madeleine, Sam. He's bolted. Bolted and gone to ground. Quite the most extraordinary thing."
"Quite," said Jane with a slight twitch of her long, thin nose.
She raised her glass of malt whiskey, which she much preferred to the more usual ladies' drink of sherry, and took a long, careful sip. She set the glass down. Yes, actually, I was aware. We had a long telephone conversation 2 nights ago, Sam and I. Please let Madeleine know that he is in excellent health and working hard at his new job.
Where? Harry demanded. What job? Why did he telephone you, of all people? Is he in Scotland?
No, he's in Yorkshire. I told him I wouldn't say exactly where just yet, if you don't mind. He'd rather a little privacy yet. Do try to understand, she said, echoing Terry, and sounding very like another young person trying to explain youth's vagaries to middle age.
What's he working at? Vanessa asked. Imagine, defrocked monk seeks employment. He must have been awfully tricky.
Hardly defrocked, Vanessa, Harry chided.
Jane smiled brightly and said, I suppose it wasn't easy. Anyhow, he's managed. She raised her glass again, as if in salute to the distant Sam.
He's in a chip shop, frying fish, she said.
Another silence fell on the beautiful drawing room as its occupants stood about with lowering jaws.
Surely never, Rodney murmured at last.
Jane looked at him, and then around the room with her slow grin spreading. Her eyes met Harry's, and he also started to grin.
What's to bother then, she asked. Happen us Hardacres, I've done worse.
Chapter 4. The Rose at Killam occupied an attractive site at the end of the village, with its own small garden at the rear facing onto a small stream with tidy grassy banks. Even in November there were flowers in the small borders and a few remaining red roses on the tall climbing bush by the front door. The building itself, of native limestone, was long and low, so that the upper floor was barely full height, with shortened windows peering out under the lowering brows of the uneven, moss-green slate roof. Jane pointed it out to her driver, who had recognised the pub already from the faded wooden sign above its door, and he pulled up in front of the many-paned bay window. The blue van drew up behind. Jane got out of the taxi, and, rather than approaching the door, stepped carefully out into the deserted street, peering in fading light the faintly suspect slope in the roof tree. She walked slowly around the gable end of the building and inspected the stonework, prodding a convenient piece of wood at the edge of one window and casting a jaundiced eye upwards to one cracked chimney pot. Oh, Philip, she said to herself, a lamb to the slaughter. She imagined she could hear the faint chortling of the estate agent all the way from York. Then, squaring her shoulders unconsciously at the prospect of the mighty reclamation project ahead, she walked back to the front of the building and rapped sharply on the door. She was aware, as she stood awaiting a response, of the subtle twitch of lace curtains in the cottage across the street. She smiled to herself. Oh yes, they'd be laughing too. The door swung in suddenly, and a tall, broad-shouldered man with thinning, sandy hair stepped half out, staring blankly at her in the twilight. Then he recognised her and opened both arms out wide. He was dressed in a huge, rough-knit jumper and tweed plus fours, with thick stockings and brogues, and for a moment Jane found it hard to believe she was actually looking at Philip Barton.
"Jane!" he shouted. "Eh, but it's grand to see you. Here, lass, let's look. Aye, but you're looking greatly."
What? Said Jane, blinking. Philip, of the London tailored suits and lifelong urbanity, had suddenly blossomed into a salt of the Yorkshire earth.
Oh, Daddy, must you? Groaned a plaintive adolescent voice from behind him. You sound so impossibly gauche.
Philip stepped aside, looking faintly hurt, and Ruth, his 15-year-old daughter, squeezed past him, as if afraid to let her stylish full skirt even brush against his offending tweeds.
Oh, Aunt Jane, he's just intolerable since we've come here. I'll die if any of my London friends ever see him. Not that that's likely, she moaned, with a mournful cast of her eyes heavenwards. I'll probably never see any of them again.
She looked dimly up and down the narrow street, with the soft outlines of the cluster of little buildings now faded into furry dusk.
Oh, this place!
She shrugged and grabbed Jane's hand, pulling her inwards as if to escape from some invading horror.
Quick, she cried with mock desperation. Talk to me. Is the world still out there? Stands Scotland where she stood? Oh God, Aunt Jane, I feel like Robinson Crusoe. Philip was still standing in the doorway, breathing ostentatious deep breaths.
Smell that, he cried, excitedly tugging at Jane's other arm. Nought but good country air. Hey, lass, yon's to life.
Ruth pushed the door closed, half on her father's brogue, with a grimace of distaste. Ruth, until a week ago, had been a student at one of London's nicer girls' day schools. She was a tall girl, looking, to Jane's eyes, surprisingly sophisticated in her soft, dark blue skirt and pale blue twin set. Her hair, dark brown like her mother's, was set in a smooth bob, just tucked in at the edges and held in place by a strand of velvet ribbon. She walked down the dark corridor leading to the kitchens of the pub with exaggerated care, conscious of herself and her new female grace. Jane followed behind, watching the bounce of soft curls on Ruth's shoulders with a small smile of pleasure. It had always delighted her to see the young come of age.
"How's your mother?" she asked. "Frantic," said Ruth. "She's been scrubbing the kitchen cupboards all day. They were full of toadstools."
"Dear me," said Jane, treading carefully on a patch of worm-eaten floorboard that sagged beneath her foot.
"And your brother and sister?"
"Out enjoying good country air," Philip put in from behind.
"More fools they," said Ruth.
Jane was about to ask the girl what arrangements had been made for her schooling when there was a sudden piercing shriek from the depths of the building.
"Good God," said Jane. "Is that Emily?"
"Aye," said Philip, excusing himself past her. "Happen we've got trouble."
He pressed on into the dark depths of the pub towards his wife's wails of distress.
"Happen," said Ruth with another grimace. "We've more than you think."
Jane smiled and patted the girl's shoulder and then hurried by to see if she could be of some assistance. She followed the shrieks, joined now by Philip's sharp barks of command, pure London now, his Yorkshire affectation sacrificed to the urgency of the moment. She found a half-open, dark-stained door and gave it a gentle push. Behind was a long, frugally furnished kitchen with a large, worn refectory table in its centre and a pair of ancient deep sinks, below which her niece, Emily, generally a woman of definite elegance, was all but invisible behind a geyser of spraying water. Soaked from the top of her once neatly waved hair to the toes of her good kid shoes, she was gamely struggling to cap the gushing pipe with her bare hands while Philip, a picture of manly fortitude, was dashing back and forth with a wrench in his hand, shouting,
"Right, pet, I've got it now, pet, hold on."
Jane stepped quietly into the rain of water, lifted the wrench from Philip's hand on one of his circuits of the scene, directed him out of doors to the mains watercock, and quietly got to work. Half an hour later, with everyone newly dried and freshly dressed, they were all sitting in the kitchen drinking tea, while Philip eulogised the astounding pressure of good Yorkshire water mains. Ruth's eyebrows rose regularly to brush her pert little fringe, and Emily, her hair in pin curls and a kerchief, sat stirring her tea with an expression of wounded martyrdom. Jane, contemplating the future of the rose at Killam, was privately giving even money that it would fall down in a cloud of dry rot or be burnt down by Emily, when the outer kitchen door banged open. She looked up to the refreshing sight of two smiling faces. Ruth's sister and brother, Olive, who was 13, and Paul, just 11, burst into the room, swinging conkers on strings and shouting in unison about entirely different subjects. Both were rosy-cheeked from the November air and deliriously excited by whatever village games they had joined, and Jane, for one, thought that in spite of Ruth's protestations, the country was already doing them a world of good.
"Mum, I've met a super girl. Her name's Ailey, and she has a pony."
"A cart horse," said Paul. "And she's really frightfully stupid. She doesn't know anything."
"Eh, by gum,"
he said in a splendid mimicry that his father must have envied.
"Nought but kentry yokels."
"Don't mock the afflicted," said Ruth.
But Paul grinned, opened his mouth wide and began to sing in a delightfully clear, childish voice.
"On ilkly moor bartat, on ilkly moor bartat, on ilkly moor bartat."
He danced around happily, his face rubbery with expression, swinging his strung conker in an arc about his head.
Ada, what's the matter with Fleur? He cried. Sol, wait!
I think, said Jane to Philip, the lad could teach his father a thing or two. Emily flared up suddenly and shouted,
That's enough now, Paul. It isn't funny any longer. Just speak English like the rest of us.
She sighed and turned to Jane with a wan smile.
Oh, do let's talk about something other than Yorkshire. How's the North? How's Heidi? Has she opened the new inn yet?
She looked with pointed sourness at her husband and added,
I do hope it's nothing like this.
Well, my dear, Jane soothed. All old buildings have their little quirks. I dare say Heidi will have a few wrinkles to iron out, too. Even as she said it, she was inwardly thanking heaven that Heidi had had the foresight to have her small property in Strathconnon thoroughly surveyed before she, with Jane's financial assistance, went through with the purchase. At least there weren't going to be two architectural disasters in the Hardacre menage just now. Heidi herself, though perhaps Jane's closest friend, was no doubt the most distant member of the Hardacre circle. Not family at all, but linked to them all just the same, by a peculiar turn of fate, now almost forgotten by everyone. Jane doubted that Ruth, for instance, could even explain what relation her Aunt Heidi bore to any of them, or why, since 1935, she'd been part of their lives. For Jane, the connection with Heidi Mueller was much older and much deeper. Although they, too, met for the first time in a Munich ghetto in that year, Jane and Heidi had known of each other since the Great War and had responded regularly throughout the 20s and early 30s. As was natural to women of their era, they had met through their husbands, who were both naval officers, Jane's in the Royal Navy and Heidi's in the forces of the Kaiser. It might be supposed that two such gentlemen on the eve of the Great War would be unlikely to speak, much less form a friendship, the ties of which would hold for 40 years. But in truth, on the spring day in 1913, when Sir Ian MacGregor and his youthful bride entertained Lieutenant Karl Müller of the German armoured cruiser Scharnhorst aboard HMS Monmouth riding at anchor off Hong Kong, no one knew themselves to be on the eve of anything. They were two small cogs in the world's two mightiest navies, and each, proud of their own and respectful of the others, regarded themselves as natural kin, with more in common than ever appeared to hold them apart. They had formed that sudden, brief, quicksilver sort of alliance that can occur between men of divergent backgrounds, but common aims. Addresses were exchanged, promises made, healths drunk, and an agreement made to surely meet again. For the two men, the meeting, or at least a meeting of the kind they envisioned, for they eventually met, indeed, in a grimmer way entirely, was never to come about. Scharnhorst sailed suddenly, leaving Jane and Ian with an odd feeling of a companionship untimely ended, and when next the two ships drew near together, it was October of 1914, in the South Pacific, over angry guns. Monmouth was the first victim, but Scharnhorst, within days, met a similar fate in the South Atlantic. The two men who had been friends in Hong Kong now both lay in the Antarctic waters forever, each leaving behind in their warring countries a young widow and fatherless child. Jane's Peter was born in November of that year, and in June of 1914, Heidi Mueller, who had shared at a distance her husband's pleasure and his Scottish friends, had given birth to a son, whom his parents named Ian after Ian MacGregor. Throughout the year, letters had been exchanged, letters filled increasingly with sorrow, as war between their native lands loomed closer. Now, with both their husbands dead, the two women, one English, one a German Jewess, instinctively grasped and held the one link with their lost loves, a friendship that they refused to allow to die. Throughout the war, they boldly, and each against the wishes of their husbands' disapprovingly patriotic families, sent letters through neutral Switzerland. After the war, Jane leapt at the chance to help Heidi, struggling in the chaos of her defeated nation by sending parcels of clothing and food. Later, as years passed, she wrote encouraging letters, trying to comfort the young widow who found that, in the new Germany, her status as honoured war widow was more and more eroded by the acid of anti-Semitism. Concerned, but in truth not fully comprehending, Jane kept her steady stream of cheery letters and useful packages flowing, until one grim day in 1933, first one and then all the others were returned with a grim official stamp. No such person at this address.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.